Very good morning to everyone, and what a joy it is that we can come to worship God as His people. And the psalmist calls us to enter His gates with thanksgiving in our hearts, and His courts, and enter with His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise, and that we should give thanks to the Lord and praise His name. Yeah. Now, especially when we come, you know, as God's people, we are always very mindful that we are here to worship the Lord as a family of God's people. Amen. And as we start the service, can I just encourage those of us who may be seated a bit further behind, unless you've got so-called people that you're waiting for and so on and so forth, perhaps if we can all stand and let's just greet one another as a family of God's people. Let's just do that and greet one another in the love of the Lord. Shall we do that? Yeah, just say hi and say welcome. You know, yeah, we come together as God's people, truly. Yeah. And the Lord be with you. We say together the collect for purity. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this: the Lord our God is the only Lord, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. Amen. Lord, have mercy upon us and write all these laws in our hearts. God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. So let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all men. Let us kneel or sit as we take a few moments to quieten our hearts before the Lord. Together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our fellow men in thought, in word, and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. Receive now the words of absolution. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As God's forgiven people, and can I invite all of us to stand now as Sister Wenting, his worship team will lead us in a time of praise and worship.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. If I ask you to describe God's love in one word, what are some of the words that you can think of? Anyone? Eunice? One word. Sorry? Big. God's love is big. Okay, good. Lynn? Okay, amazing, yes. So, as we sing the first song, let us read through the lyrics. I know this is a very familiar song for most of us, but let us not just sing it blindly. Let us remember God's love is warm, God's love is deep, God's love is brighter than anything we know.
Love it.
sense that your love is so warm for us. Your love is so deep for us that we can never comprehend fully. And now we want to come to you with praise in our mouth. We want to come to you with thanksgiving. For it's to you that we sing. We proclaim you as our King. We give you our glory. We give you your glory, Lord. Thank you for being the keeper of our heart. I will come to you with praise in my mouth. I will worship at your throne with thanksgiving. Sing to the Lord. It's to you that I sing, proclaiming you as King and give you glory. You are counselor and friend, the beginning and the end. You're the keeper of my heart. I will worship you in spirit and truth. Lift up your hands. Set us free. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Please be seated.
Today's scripture passage is Acts chapter 16, verses 16 to 34. I'll read from the book of Acts, chapter 16, verses 16 to 34. As we were going to the place of prayer, we were met by a slave girl who had a spirit of divination and brought her owners much gain by fortune telling. She followed Paul and us, crying out, "These men are servants of the Most High God who who proclaimed to you the way of salvation. And this she kept doing for many days. Paul, having become greatly annoyed, turned and said to the Spirit, I command you, in the name of Jesus Christ, to come out of her. And it came out that very hour. But when her owners saw that their hope of gain was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the rulers. And when they had brought them to the magistrates, they said, These men are Jews, and they are disturbing our city. They advocate customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to accept or practice. The crowd joined in attacking them, and the magistrates tore the garments off them and gave orders to beat them with rods. And when they had inflicted many blows upon them, they threw them into prison, ordering the jailer to keep them safely. Having received this order, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. And suddenly, there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open and everyone's bonds were unfastened. When the jailer woke and saw that the prison doors were open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, supposing that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul cried with a loud voice, Do not harm yourself, for we are all here. And the jailer called for lights and rushed in, and trembling with fear, he fell down before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them out and he said, Sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household. And they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their wounds, and he was baptized at once, he and all his family. Then he brought them up into his house and set food before them. And he rejoiced, along with his entire household, that he had believed in God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we come before your word this morning, enable us to hear your voice afresh and anew, and empower us by your Spirit to live in accordance with your word and your will. In Jesus' name, amen. Last Wednesday was Ascension Day. Did y'all know that? Okay. And that's when we remember the occasion when our Lord Jesus was taken up into glory on the Mount of Olives in the presence of his disciples. And this was after Jesus had given the disciples specific instruction to wait in Jerusalem until they had received power from on high before they went out to be his witnesses. Witnessing for the Lord is not something that can be accomplished through human determination, fervor, zeal, or strength. I say that again. Witnessing for the Lord cannot be accomplished by human determination, fervor, zeal, or strength. We can only do so in the power of the Holy Spirit. Our Lord Jesus himself knew that. That was why he asked his disciples to wait in Jerusalem until they had received power from the Lord. Jesus himself relied on the Holy Spirit and his power in the course of his life and earthly ministry. For instance, when we read about how Jesus, when he went into the wilderness to be tested by the devil, Luke chapter 4, verses 1 to 2, tells us, and Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted by the devil. What does this tell us? You know, Jesus going into the wilderness to face the devil was not his own idea. He was led there by the Holy Spirit. You know, sometimes people can be extremely brave, or some would call foolish, to go and challenge spiritual powers. Yeah, and I've heard many stories about that, which didn't end well. Here in this case, you find that Jesus himself was full of the Holy Spirit, and he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to face the devil. When Jesus was about to start his ministry, Luke tells us again in Luke 4, verse 14 to 15, and Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee. He returned from the wilderness in the power of the Holy Spirit again. And a report about him went out through all the surrounding country. And he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. So it is quite obvious that at the onset of Jesus' earthly ministry, he himself needed and relied on the power of the Holy Spirit. Of course, he himself, when he went back to his hometown in Nazareth, it's recorded that he said in Luke 4, 18 to 19, a quotation from Isaiah 61, where Jesus himself said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." This year, for our church, the overarching theme is the year of the Lord's favor, and is drawn from this passage itself. Now, as you can see, this whole ministry of even setting captives free, of proclaiming, you know, of healing the blind, and to liberate those who are oppressed, was an initiative of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And the second sentence says, he has sent me. The Holy Spirit has sent Jesus. He was led by the Spirit. He was inspired by the Spirit. He was empowered by the Holy Spirit to do the works, the mighty works of God. Hallelujah. So Jesus himself relied on the power of the Holy Spirit to do God's work. And what's more, now, on the day of ascension, and Jesus actually said very clearly to his disciples that they need the Holy Spirit's power as well. As much as Jesus himself did, he was now going to make the same provision for his disciples. And so we read in Acts chapter 1, verses 4 and 8. And verse 4 says, "While staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you heard from me." And verse 8 says, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth." Jesus reckoned that the disciples needed the power of the Holy Spirit to witness, to be his witnesses. And it's very interesting, he didn't suggest to them, he didn't propose to them, he ordered them to wait in Jerusalem until they have received power from on high. Until that happens, don't do anything, don't go anywhere. It's very important that as God's people, we need to wait on the Lord, we need to listen to the Lord. And in today's passage, we read an account of how Paul and Silas, as well as all the other apostles, you can read through the whole book of Acts, they went out in the power of the Spirit, and they did God's work, proclaim the good news in the power of the Holy Spirit. And so in our passage today, we see Paul and Silas themselves on their way to the place of prayer in Philippi. Now, this was shortly after the conversion and baptism of Lydia and her household, the first converts in Europe. Yeah. And along the way, we are told a slave girl who had the spirit of divination met them and began to follow Paul. And various events followed which appeared to threaten Paul and Silas's efforts to witness. Let's see what happened and be encouraged also in our own witness for the Lord. We'll look at this under 2 points. First of all, powerful witness. And secondly, the power of praise. Powerful witness and power of praise. First of all, powerful witness. We are told that the slave girl who had a spirit of divination was a nuisance. She had followed Paul and was crying out, "These men are servants of the Most High God who proclaim to you the way of salvation. Pay attention, listen." And this went on for many days. And Paul became greatly annoyed. So what did he do? He cast out the spirit out of the girl in Jesus' name. They didn't need the witness or testimony of an evil spirit. Yeah, they only needed the Holy Spirit himself to empower them for their witness. They don't need any other endorsement from any alternative source. The evil spirit, we are told, left that girl that very hour. Now, we would have thought that would be quite a happy outcome. This girl is set free, you know, and everybody should be rather happy, right? However, we are told that the owners of the slave girl had made their living through this girl's ability to tell fortunes. So now, on seeing this ability gone, they had no more source of income. So what did they do? They got very upset. They seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the rulers and accused them of advocating foreign customs that were unlawful for them as Romans to accept or practice. The crowd was also attacking Paul and Silas. And on learning what they had done, the magistrates had Paul and Silas' garments torn and had them beaten with rods. Now, that's the way they meted out justice in those days, I suppose. After they had been beaten severely, Paul and Silas were thrown into prison. And the jailer was ordered to keep them securely. As such, Paul and Silas were put into the inner prison. That means right in the depths of the building. And their feet were also fastened to the stocks. And this was to ensure that there is no possibility for them of escape. Friends, witnessing for Christ can at times be risky business. While the gospel brings salvation and sets those in bondage free, this may not always be welcome. People who have been used to a particular system of belief or religion may not find such messages welcome, let alone good news. And it's pretty true for those who come from an idolatrous or pagan background or context. All the more so if they had been making a reputation or they're living through such means. I recall a testimony of a man who lived in Indonesia, in Tanjung Pinang. How many of you know where Tanjung Pinang is? How many of you have been to Tanjung Pinang, the Riau Islands? Okay, some of you I know have been on those mission trips, yeah? And this man, he's called Brother Go, okay? Not come and go, but Go, Brother Go. And he came from a family that had maintained a shrine in that town. Everyone in that town would make offerings at that shrine and had their fortunes told. From time to time, different members of the family, usually the men, would allow the spirit of that shrine to possess them and put them in a trance. And in that state, the person would be able to perform superhuman feats of strength as well as to tell fortunes. And so the Go family became famous and wealthy through this. They were the Go-to family, sorry. Couldn't resist that one. One day, Brother Go decided to leave his family's belief and he became a Christian. He was filled with the Spirit. Not too long thereafter, he decided to return to his hometown. And he was met in that town by one of his brothers who heard that Brother Go was coming back. And this brother became fuming mad and told him to wait in the town while he went home to fetch his broadsword. You know those Chinese Kung Fu movies, yeah? Those things, yeah? The big one. So he wanted to teach Brother Go a lesson for bringing shame to their family's name and reputation in the community. On reaching home, this brother took his broadsword and invoked the spirit to possess him before he went to meet Brother Go in the middle of the town. And when he got there, he found Brother Go waiting for him. And his brother shouted and charged at him violently with the broadsword. Ah! And swinging the broadsword to strike him, his brother saw all his strikes just glancing off, as if being deflected by some invisible shield. Tried as he did, he just could not hit Brother Go. The brother then tried to plunge the broadsword into him. This too was deflected. And Brother Go was just simply standing still and praying quietly in tongues. And he relied on the power of the Holy Spirit to protect him. And by this time, the town people had already gathered, you know, to see what was the commotion. And they too were stunned by what they saw. Frustrated, the brother broke the broadsword into two. That's how strong he was. And ran off. And the amazing and wonderful outcome of this was that Brother Go was able to then bear gospel witness to all who saw what was happening. And this actually resulted in a good number of them coming to faith in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Another remarkable outcome that was that Brother Go managed to witness to members of his family, including that brother who had tried to kill him. And he led them to faith in Christ. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Friends, while most of us may never experience anything as challenging as to a Christian faith and witness, we can nonetheless take heart and be confident that the Lord is with us to enable us to witness for Him in His power and in His strength. We don't rely on our own cleverness, our own strength. We need to rely on the power that God has provided for us through His Holy Spirit. And while we may not be necessarily delivered on every occasion from being maligned or falsely accused, being beaten up, or even being jailed, we can be assured that when we witness in the power of the Holy Spirit, God Himself will do the work of conviction. After all, the Scripture tells us it is the Holy Spirit who brings conviction of sin and lead many to faith and salvation. We are just simply His messengers. We're just simply His vessels. And let the Holy Spirit reveal His glory and His power through us. Friends, such a witness is powerful. The sick are healed. The oppressed are set free. And those who are in darkness are brought to see the light, which leads them to salvation. And it certainly brings about the blessings and the favor of the Lord. Amen? Amen? Secondly, power of praise. You know, while Paul and Silas were in jail, what were they doing in the middle of the night? It was about midnight. Were they licking their wounds, lamenting their circumstances? Oh, poor me. You know, I was just trying to be faithful to the Lord. How did I end up this way, you know? Were they cursing and swearing? Were they complaining or murmuring against God? Were they feeling depressed? I mean, if they were feeling depressed, they wouldn't sing, right? Were they focused on consoling and comforting each other? Not at all. They were praying and praising God. How about that? And all the other prisoners were listening too. Obviously, they were kept awake. I mean, these two guys just going on singing, you know. And as they were doing that, something amazing happened. There was a great earthquake, and the foundations of the prison were shaken. All the prison doors, we're told, were open, and everyone's bonds became unfastened. When the jailer awoke, he saw what had happened and was about to kill himself as he thought that all the prisoners had escaped. And as those of you may know, in those days, if you are entrusted to guard a prisoner, you have to guard the prisoner at the cost of your life. If the prisoner escapes, you have to pay with your life. That was how it was. What did Paul do? Well, Paul stopped him by crying in a loud voice, saying, they were all there. And when the lights were brought in, the jailer was trembling with fear, and he fell at Paul and Silas's feet and asked, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Now, how did he get this notion, what must I do to be saved? It was quite obvious that Paul and Silas, in the course of, you know, preaching in the town for many days, the jailer would have heard, Paul and Silas, directly or indirectly, about what they were preaching about, believe in the Lord Jesus and to be saved. And so Paul and Silas said to the jailer, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household. And Paul and Silas explained God's word further to him and to members of his household. And the jailer washed Paul and Silas' wounds, and he and his family were then baptized. The jailer rejoiced together with his family that he had believed in God. Hallelujah. You know, when we come to faith in Jesus Christ, it is a joyful thing. Amen? It is a joyful thing where we have come to know the Lord and His salvation. Yeah? You know, if so-and-so come to faith in Christ, you hear new somebody comes to faith in Christ, let us learn to rejoice. Amen? Because heaven rejoices over every sinner who repents. What more us? Yeah? Sometimes when we hear somebody say, oh, this person has come to faith in Christ, you know? Oh, it's about time. You know, don't do that. Oh, why so long? No, should happen sooner. La. But we rejoice, okay? Let's learn to rejoice. Amen? Amen? Praise the Lord. Yeah? Hallelujah. Friends, when we undergo trials or sufferings, what do we do? What should we do? Do we, like Paul and Silas, acknowledge God in our circumstance? Do we pray? Do we praise and worship God wherever we are, regardless of whatever situation we may be in? If so, we should not at all be surprised if God somehow intervenes sovereignly and powerfully in our situation. Hallelujah. I like that, Lano. This may not result in our escape, you know, but it will certainly result in the advance of our Christian witness amongst those around us. Hallelujah? Lionel? Hallelujah? He's listening, eh? Out of the mouth of babes, God has ordained praise. Hallelujah? Perhaps even to lead some, if not all, to faith in Christ. You know, in the account of the jailer and his household's conversion, it actually took a combination of events, you may say, to bring about this joyful outcome of his salvation and that of his household. I don't know if any of you may have experienced a personal or even a family crisis that eventually led to a wonderful outcome. And I personally have at different times of my own life. I'd like to share with you one such situation. There was an occasion that happened in early 1987. And this had to do with my own late father, who was at that time a very, very backslidden Christian. I didn't even have any idea that he was a backslidden Christian at that time. He had become such a staunch adherent of another religion. For all the years since I had become a Christian, I had been praying for his salvation. And when friends asked, you know, how long do you think your dad may eventually come to faith? I didn't know he had been a Christian, right? And I would say, well, maybe 10, maybe 20 years when he's older, you know, and he's maybe a bit more open. My late father was so dead set against Christianity, and he had even made that explicitly known to me on different occasions. I remember one time at my convocation, and he came down from Malaysia. And so, I shared with him about my plans to study in a Bible school and to be trained to be a pastor. He was so upset. He was livid, in fact. And he said to my mom, see what happened to your son? Your son, you know, not his son. And without going to all the details, there was a crisis that happened during Chinese New Year in 1987. And you know, being from a traditional Chinese home, Chinese New Year is very important, right? The whole family together. And this resulted, actually, in some members of my family leaving the house for good. And the one that only remained was my mom, my late mother. And my late father was shocked beyond belief that this thing could have possibly happened to him. And he actually asked my mother, he never asked my mother this ever before, what did I do wrong? You know, men from that kind of generation, they never ask such questions, right? What did I do wrong? And of course, my mom, in all her innocence and boldness, told him everything the whole night. And this eventually led my dad to repent and return to the Lord. He was 65 years old at that time, and he actually left the faith for 40 years. 40 years, my friends. But God, in His grace and mercy, powerfully intervened in his life and brought him back to Himself. Hallelujah. When my dad went back to church for the first time after so many years to worship God, tears were streaming down his face. And to be honest with you, I have never, ever, ever seen my dad cry. He was a police officer. He made people cry. I'm not suggesting our police officers here make people cry. If you make them cry, hallelujah, that's great. My dad was a very tough man. So I've seen how he dealt with people, so I can imagine. But God can touch the heart or even the toughest person. Isn't God wonderful? Isn't He amazing? There may be loved ones in our family amongst our family members who have yet to come to know the Lord or who have yet to come back to the Lord. Don't give up. God can still do some amazing things beyond our expectation and belief. It might be through a crisis. I hope not. But who knows? If we allow God to have His way, we pray that, Lord, You have Your way. Whatever, however You want to do it, please bring this person to You. Please bring this person back to You. And we pray along those lines in faith. And let's see what happens. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Isn't it wonderful? Over every sinner who repents. I thank God. You know, every time I think of my dad coming back to faith, wow. Praise God. He makes all things beautiful in His time. Friends, we may not necessarily see things happen or result in accordance with our prayers or supplications or expectations or timing even. However, what we can be assured of is that God Himself will act, and He will do so in such ways that we may not even expect. I don't think Paul and Silas were at all expecting the events that happened when they were praying and praising God. Earthquake, prison doors open, all the shackles unfastened. They were not ready to go anywhere. Perhaps they knew, yeah. But what they only wanted to do was to simply witness to the other prisoners who were listening to them. What was clear is that they trusted God in their circumstance. They remained spiritually vigilant and alert to act and respond when the Lord acted. In that instance, it wasn't so that they may escape physically from prison, but in order that that may result, you know, in the jailer and his household coming to faith in Christ. So like Paul and Silas, I believe we should always stay spiritually vigilant and prayerful, so that we may act in line and in sync with what God may sovereignly desire to do or intervene. Friends, when God acts, let us always be found in that position where we are ready to act in line with what God is doing accordingly. In the meanwhile and in all times, let us continue to remain faithful in our Christian witness and in prayer. Let us keep praising and worshiping God in whatever circumstance we may be in. He may yet shake things up in such a way to bring about an outcome that leads people to faith and salvation. Hallelujah. In closing, let me say that the Lord is sovereign. You know, we're reminded this morning of God's love. Yeah, how God loves us. Yeah. And that love that nothing can overcome, that nothing can conquer, that nothing can separate. You know what? God is at work. God is at work when we allow Him to use us in ways beyond our imagination, that we trust Him and trust that He loves us, regardless of whatever circumstance we may find ourselves in. because he loves us. And let us allow the Lord to use us in that way. The Lord is sovereign. The key is for us to avail ourselves for him, for his use. And as we witness in the power that he provides, let us not be afraid. Let us not be anxious, because God is well able to work powerfully through our weakness. You know, one of the amazing things that God does is that he uses ordinary vessels, like you and I, to do extraordinary things, so that the glory goes to him, so that his grace and power may be revealed through us who believe. We cannot be full of ourselves. We can only be full of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let us continue to rely on the power that the Holy Spirit gives us to enable us to bear witness to the Lord. Let us never cease praying and praising him in whatever circumstance we may find ourselves in. There is power in praise. Paul, actually, the apostle, gave very good advice to the Thessalonian Christians when he said to them in 1 Thessalonians 5:16 to 18, "Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you." Do you know there's a song that's sung using some of these words? Have you heard it before? Rejoice evermore, for this is the will of God. Rejoice evermore, for this is the will of God. Rejoice evermore, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Can we try that together? 1, 2, 3. Rejoice evermore, for this is the will of God. Rejoice evermore, for this is the will of God. Rejoice evermore, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing, for this is the will of God. Pray without ceasing, for this is the will of God. Pray without ceasing, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. In everything give thanks. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. All three, rejoice. Rejoice evermore, for this is the will of God. Pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing, for this is the will of God. In everything give thanks. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. I'm confident that as we heed this advice, the Lord may yet act powerfully in sovereign and surprising ways that will result in the advance of our Christian witness to his praise and glory. Shall we pray? Lord, as the Apostle Paul and Silas themselves, Lord, rejoice and praise you and pray, Lord, even in prison, and they never cease to give thanks to you in every circumstance. Lord, you did such a marvelous and powerful, Lord, work in them and how you use them to be your powerful witnesses. Help us, O God, to do no less, to learn to rejoice in you always, and again to rejoice, to pray without ceasing, to pray in all circumstances, to give thanks to you in all circumstances, Lord, and to see your hand, your power that will be revealed, and to bring about light and life and salvation to all who hear. For we ask and pray all these in Jesus' name. Amen.
Believe in the Lord and you will be saved, you and your household. What a wonderful God. Let's rise in response to the sermon and sing a song of praise to Jesus. Jesus, our living hope. Finished, the end is written.
remain standing for the Apostles' Creed. Let us reaffirm our faith through these words together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We say together the collect for today, the Sunday after Ascension Day. Eternal God, the King of glory, You have exalted Your only Son with great triumph to Your kingdom in heaven. Leave us not comfortless, but send Your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and exalt us to the place where Christ has gone before, where with You and the Holy Spirit He is worshipped and glorified now and forever. Amen. Let us kneel or sit as we now enter the time of intercession.
Thank You, Jesus, for overcoming sin and death with Your victory on the cross, that we can be redeemed and reconciled with You, Lord, our Father in heaven. As Psalms 18 says, "The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength in whom I will trust, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I will call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies." Thank You, Lord, for being the Lord in whom we can trust and the rock on whom we can stand upon. While we do not understand everything that is happening in this world, Lord, help us to be still and know that You are God and Your sovereign. We ask, Lord, that You would bring light where there is darkness, help in time of need, comfort in the midst of trouble, peace in the midst of strife, hope in times of uncertainty, healing to those who have been hurt physically or even emotionally and mentally, faith where there was fear, life where there was death, and love where there was hatred. Open the eyes of our heart, Lord, to see the world through Your eyes and to act in accordance to Your will and purpose. Enable our hearts, Lord, to find rest in You, to trust that You are faithful and in Your promises, even more so for all that lies ahead of us, because You have overcome the world. Help us, Lord, to find true and everlasting peace, even as we place our hope, our joy and our future in Your hands. We pray now for our country, Singapore, even as we continue living in these unprecedented times of uncertainty, where we feel that many things could be out of anyone's control. In these challenges and demands, as we face them, we pray that You grant our leaders especially the grace and the wisdom to be able to lead our nation in ways that will be able to bless and benefit all who live and work here for the progress and well-being of our country. May You, Lord, enable them to find favour and success in all their endeavours and to advance policies that will be able to build and strengthen this nation, Lord, in ways that will glorify You, Lord, and would serve Your purposes. We also want to pray for our Diocese of Singapore. We pray especially for the parish of St. James Church, the Vicar Canon Chua Siang Guan, the clergy Reverend Tang Wai Long, Reverend Andrew Yap, Reverend Glenn Chan, the parish workers and assistants, Mr. Henry Yeo, Madam Caroline Wong, Mr. Jason Teo, Ms. Tai Xiaoting, the missionary clergy, Canon Yi Ching Hua, and also for the Chinese congregation priest, Reverend Yap Chi Han, his parish assistant, Mr. Nicholas Chong, and also for the three principals of St. James Church Kindergarten, Mrs. Cheng Shu Min, Mrs. Chua Bi Lian, and Mrs. Eudora Lim. Grant Your wisdom and grace, Lord, to be upon the clergy, the staff, the workers at St. James Church and the kindergartens, and unite them, Lord, in Your spirit. We pray the same for our own Holy Trinity Church pastoral team and church workers. Father God, You know that a number of them were down with the COVID infection at the start of last week. And we want to thank You, Lord, for watching over the ones who have recovered. May You continue to grant a speedy and complete healing to those who remain on the road of recovery. Grant them too protection, Lord, from any long-term effects of the COVID virus
and for their families, especially the elderly and the vulnerable in their midst. Thank you, Lord, for the Fuchao and congregations. They have come together in unity of mind and purpose. We want to pray for the upcoming Chinese Congregation Extraordinary General Meeting that will be taking place on the 5th of June, that this merger, Lord, will allow our church to truly be unified in one common vision and purpose for you, Lord, that we may be able to fully receive your favor and blessings upon us. Let us now spend a moment of quietness and commit the names of those who we know are suffering in body, mind, or spirit in prayer. Just as you have called us, Lord, to love our neighbors as ourselves, help us, Lord, to continue praying for these people and others in their time of suffering and need. Grant them, Lord, your comfort, your healing, courage, and hope in their troubles, and help them to experience the joy of your salvation. I pray too, Lord, that you will continue to fill and guide us in your spirit, that we will never cease praying and praising your name. All this we ask and pray in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Shall we all stand together to share the peace? We are the body of Christ in the one spirit. We were all baptized in the one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let's share the peace of Christ with one another. You may be seated. Just want to draw your attention to a number of announcements. First of all, a very warm welcome to all of you. Anyone who's here visiting or that you're here for the first time today, we want to acknowledge you. Just wave your hand where you are. Is there anyone? Okay, everyone has been here before. Great. Okay, that's fine. I just want to make mention of a few notices. First of all is the 80th anniversary family photo shoot. It begins today. So those of you who have signed up, please kindly note your time slots. And for those who have yet to sign up, please could you, do so without delay, so as to ensure that your photos are in this anniversary book. Next, Biblical Signs for Our Time by Reverend Dr. So Guan Chin. Some people have been asking questions, is the end near? Is there a biblical perspective to all that is happening in the world today? Well, if such are your questions as well as others, and you probably want to understand, for instance, a little bit better the book of Revelation and the things that Jesus had said about the end times, then this was for you. It's on over 2 days, or rather starts on Friday the 29th evening, 6:30 to 10, and continuing on Saturday, 9 a.m. to 12, and then 6:30 to 10. So the cost is $25. And registration cost details are in your e-bulletin, yeah? So I just want to commend that to you. I understand that some have already signed up, so that's wonderful. Next, please can we kindly uphold the family of the late Sister Ivy, who had gone home to be with the Lord, and please pray for her mother, Daisy, as well as for her husband, William, and her daughter, 16-year-old daughter, Priscilla, and her brother, Eugene. Please kindly keep this family in your prayers. And there's a funeral wake service tonight, from last night, and tonight at 8 p.m., Block 445 at Haogang Avenue 8. Block 445, Haogang Avenue 8, 8 p.m. And there's going to be a brief encoffining service tomorrow at 1:15 p.m. The cottage will then leave for Mandai Crematorium, Hall 2 for a funeral service, at 2:20 p.m. Yeah, so tonight 8 p.m. tomorrow 1:15 and coffining at the Block 445 Haogang Avenue 8, and Mandai Crematorium Hall 2 at 2:20 p.m. Let's pray. Father God, we just want to commit, Lord, and commend the family of our late sister Ivy to you. We pray especially for Daisy, for William, for Priscilla, and for Eugene, that in their time of grief, that you will be especially present with them, and that, Lord, you comfort them and fill their hearts with your peace, and be with them throughout this day and the next few days, and all that they are going through at this point in time. In Jesus' name, amen. The tithes and offerings, the details are there for those of you who are doing so electronically, and for those who wish to do so in the physical envelopes, there's the offering box on your way out, as well as on this side on the way to the lift. I'd like to invite Wen Ting and worship team to come and lead us in our offertory song. One more item before I forget. Next Sunday, because of the Chinese Congregation EGM, will be conducted here. So our English service for the 11 o'clock service will be meeting downstairs. Okay, just for next week. Okay, thank you.
Let's rise for the offertory.
Christ our King, make you faithful and strong to do his will, that you may reign with him in glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. We sing together now the closing song.
Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus,
Christmas.
Stay behind for silent meditation. God bless you.